Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 7th meeting of the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee in 2022. Before we begin, can I remind those using electronic devices to switch them to silent. Our first and only item of business this morning is an evidence session with stakeholders on the Sea Fish Prohibition on Fishing Firth of Clyde Order 2022, SSI 2022/35. And I welcome to the meeting, our first panel consisting of fishing organisations. We have Simon MacDonald, the chair of the West Coast Regional Inshore Fisheries Group, Sean McElraith, the Galloway Static Gear Association, Alistair Bally-Philp, the National Coordinator of the Scottish Creel Fishermen's Federation, and Elaine White, the Executive Secretary from the Clyde Fishermen's Association. We have about 45 minutes for questions this morning. I'm going to kick off. So my first questions to all the panel are, what impacts will the closure have on fishers in the Clyde? And specifically, what extent has the changes made in the revised number two order, and how will it mitigate those impacts? And if we start with Simon, please.
Yes, good morning. The whole thing will have an effect to a degree on the fishers, not as great as was originally forecast to be. I got a call the evening before the announcement was made that there would be the cod spawning closure, but all the exceptions were being removed. So, of course, needless to say, there was a lot of hurried calls back and forward. We had a meeting a few days later with Marine Scotland and other stakeholders to discuss the matter further, and it was decided that there would be an area that could still be opened for fishing, because generally cod do not spawn on mud. They'll spawn on rocky, shingly and gravel areas instead. The langoustine or nephrop fishery in the Clyde is a very, very important sector of our fisheries. And it's so important and vital that this fishery should continue. So there were drawings and plans brought up at the meeting to show clearly the areas where it would have to be closed off, because that is where the cod were reckoned to be actually spawning. But it was leaving a good corridor open, covering all the muddy area. Since then, obviously, the decision has been made to cut some of the muddy area off so that it doesn't encroach on the cod. Cod are very sensitive to sound. So this was to prevent the cod from being spooked and not spawning. So there is still area there for fishing to continue, and that applies to both mobile and static gear. I know there are concerns about the area being reduced, so it means that there are issues possibly pertaining to conflict with trawlers and creel boats.
Sean McElraith, please.
Hey there. Well, the only thing I first heard about this closure, I'm fishing for lobster and crab, coming out from Loch Ryan and fishing up to the Binning Head, just north of Ballantrae. Now, all our gear's been in that area, in this closed box. We feel like it's been like a sneak attack, because we didn't know anything about this. Now, I heard it online through Facebook, believe it or not, and that was like, I had 1 month to shift my gear kind of thing. So the weather's been really bad, which it was a struggle to actually get it over the line to comply. So we'd got some kind of gear over the line by the closing date, but the weather kind of hurt on the last big storm, and we've kind of lost some creels out of it, but so I suppose we've kind of had an impact already. We've not really had much fishing done since then, but it's It's certainly going to be a struggle to work out the new ground and stuff like that. And by the time they work that out, it's going to hopefully open again and time to move. Obviously, we've kind of got like bigger expenses of diesel and stuff like for steaming about. We've got the option of working out a girvan, but then that will become tidal and we can't like leave our catch in there safe. It would have to be left at the sea and stored, obviously at risk of weather and stuff like that. We've got the added pressure of harbour dues for girvan, so it's all in all, it's not been very good start for us.
Okay, thank you. And Ballyphilp.
I think. I think the impacts of the original proposal were quite devastating across all the sectors. The whole southern part of the Clyde looked like it was going to be closed. The mitigations from the changed proposal, I think it certainly alleviates the impacts for some of the Clyde vessels. However, I think for the static gear boats that are working the prawn fishery, which is a fishery that takes place on the soft mud, I don't think the amended proposal mitigates anything for them. Now, I appreciate the mitigated proposal opens up about 30% of the area previously proposed to be closed, and that area is mostly nephrops ground, soft mud. However, I think it's worth noting that you can't fish prawn keels in the same area as you have prawn trawlers. Now, the business regulatory impact assessment refers to keel ground. I'm not quite sure what that is. I think it means hard ground where the trawlers don't work, where maybe the crab and the lobster fisheries take place. However, keel ground is exactly the same thing as trawl ground when it comes to the nephrops fishery. And unless there's some sort of spatial management or allocation of zones for keels and for trawlers, opening up nephrops ground or muddy areas within the Clyde does nothing to alleviate the problem for the keel boats. They're essentially disbarred from fishing these areas if those areas are going to be occupied by trawlers at the same time. I think that what that means is that for the few nephrops keel boats that are impacted, the impacts are quite dramatic, and the mitigations from the amended policy do nothing to lessen that. The business and regulatory impact assessment does acknowledge that the keel boats, the smallest keel boats, will have the biggest trouble moving. So it sort of explicitly acknowledges that the impacts would be greatest for those boats, but we don't see any kind of proposals to mitigate for those boats who we're already acknowledging are the most adversely impacted. So for a small group of boats, especially the nephrops keel boats, I'd say the impacts are quite dramatic, and the changed policy does nothing to mitigate that.
Thank you. And Elaine White.
Thank you very much. I think in the first thing I would say, you said how it's impacted people. I think the first thing to say is trust in process has been a massive impact, because a lot of fishermen still don't understand even why this has happened because of the speed and the confusion with the level of consultation. I will say that there was a number of consultations came out or were revised, and I had fishermen phoning me saying, have I actually responded to this already or haven't I? It was such a confusing landscape for them. Even I was confused. In terms of how fast things were moving. I think as well, financially, of course, it's had a massive impact. We have had mobile boats that have lost areas, but more significantly, we have had keel boats that have completely lost their areas and have no other option to go anywhere. So I personally have three families who are directly impacted by this. I think the wording used was a short impact. It's not a short impact. It's 3 months of no income for boats, with hardly any warning to do anything else, to diversify, to go anywhere else. So that isn't that's not a short impact. And I think more long term, the impact is markets. We've just come through COVID, we've just come through Brexit. We are trying to build up our EU markets again. These are the markets that particularly the live and fresh boats will be reliant on. We're talking about strangling supply for about 4 months of the year, and that is going to have a massive impact on who wants to work with us going forward in terms of the EU. So you're putting us at a regional disadvantage to other areas, potentially in the UK, but also to other EU countries like Ireland or various other places that can supply that product. I think so. In terms of the financial impact, we have asked if there would be some kind of compensation for these men, because they didn't have warning of what's happening, and we haven't heard anything back from that yet. We will commend a lot of our MSPs who have done the best that they can to do that, but to pursue that. I think in terms of also the static gear, obviously they can't move. I would say that our fleet in the Clyde has reduced by 50% over the last few years anyway. But they're very old boats. They're the oldest ageing boat in the whole of Scotland. They're not safe to be going out various other areas. They don't have that option. So I think that's very concerning. Also, the increased effort is a concern, because it's not a large area. So you're going to have potentially keel boats fighting other keel boats. You're going to have mobile conflict with other keel boats. It's causing a lot of conflict. And I think the main issue is that this should have went through the IFGs. It should have been fully explained to fishermen in terms of what was happening. And I think if there had been engagement with the local fishermen, we could have come up with a system that would have worked. I think the massive impact here as well is the lack of science and how that can negatively affect management and fisheries going forward. And we really need to get that sorted out. Thank you.
Thank you. I've got a supplementary from Mercedes Villalba.
Thank you. Yeah, it was just on the point about, I think it was raised by Simon, about cod not spawning in muddy areas. But I understand that the evidence on that isn't conclusive, and that in Sweden, cod have been found to spawn in a muddy, sheltered body of water that's similar to the Clyde. So I suppose I was interested to hear from the witnesses whether they feel that more research should be done into this before a decision is made.
Simon, would you like to respond to that?
Yes, indeed. I mean, this whole thing, there was really a great lack of consultation beforehand. As I'd stated earlier, I was only informed of this the evening before the announcement was actually made. So it did not give me any time to then work on, informing the other fishers. The science evidence seems to be very sketchy and has not really been carried out for quite some time. So there is a great need to have more scientific evidence and a concentration on that in this very, very important area. And it needs to really be done now while we still have a fishery. I mean, this doesn't just affect the boats, but it's all the coastal communities around, the processors, the hauliers, local businesses and suppliers to the fishermen, and even the local corner shops are going to be affected, because there's so many fishermen left with absolutely no income. But we do need to have a strong effort on the scientific aspect of this to establish just exactly where the cod are spawning in the Clyde. And I would be most surprised to see if they were actually spawning on the muddy area.
Thank you. Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. I'm interested to hear, perhaps firstly from Mr. MacDonald, about the science around this. Obviously, and I've said this, or I've conveyed this, obviously I'm slightly disappointed that we don't have government scientists here today, but it'd be interesting to know your view about the science here, and particularly the science around the decision to move away from the initial proposals from the government, and what you've been informed about that.
Well, I mean, I still feel that there has not been sufficient scientific input over the years, or certainly in recent times, to establish the full pattern of exactly where the cod are. I mean, it's given that they would generally spawn on the rockier ground rather than on the mud, but we do need a strong backup on this to establish the total facts. The Clyde closure is nothing new. It's been going for really the past 20 years or so, and was actually instigated very much by the Clyde fishermen themselves. If you want a conservationist, ask a fisherman. because their livelihood and their future and their family's future depends on the conservation of the stocks in the waters to which they fish. So it is so important that the scientific assessment is brought up to date.
Well, as I say, hopefully we'll get that some more on that next week. But I would like to ask Alistair Philp again about how stakeholders were involved in the process of moving away. Obviously, the areas closed were reduced by some 28%. So how were stakeholders consulted in that process?
There was a meeting, an online meeting with Marine Scotland, where they announced that they were considering looking at various options, and the present proposal was shared. There was a couple of maps displayed to the people present. One was something called VMS, so it's Vessel Monitoring System maps, and they showed where the intensity of fishing was in the Clyde, although it's worth noting that VMS is only installed in vessels over 12 metres, so it predominantly showed where the activities of the trawl and the dredge fleet were within the Clyde. And then we were shown another set of maps which showed the seabed substrate, the mud and the shale and rocks and so on. And what Marine Scotland suggested was that because they thought mud was not an ideal spawning ground, and the VMS showed where the fishing activity was, by allocating the area that they had identified, they would maximise the amount of ground they could open up to the fishing industry, whilst we minimising the impacts of that process on the cod spawning. We objected at the time because the VMS was identifying areas that were predominantly operated in by trawl and dredge fleet, which, you know, is good for them, but obviously that doesn't mitigate the impacts on the creel fleet, and we requested that there was some sort of mitigation introduced for the creel fleet, but that wasn't accepted at that time.
As I understand it, the closure came into effect on the 14th of February, so I wonder, could you say a bit about to what extent fishermen, or could you explain to the committee to what extent fishermen are still able to fish, and whether you feel there's any issues around compliance on that?
So I think the for those people who removed their gear in time before the gale struck, I think you know, for these guys, they've either abandoned their gear where it is, or they've moved their gear somewhere else. But if they haven't had the opportunity to move their gear, then they're in a bit of a sticky predicament. I do believe there's been some negotiations with compliance about opening up the option for people whose gear is essentially trapped in the closed area to access the gear to remove it. But that still, you know, begs the question of where exactly should they be moving it to.
Convener.
Elaine White, would you like to respond to that line of questioning?
Yes, of course. I mean, it's predominantly my members, both static and mobile, who were impacted by the closure. And to be honest with you, Billy is entirely correct. They couldn't even access the gear initially. We did have to negotiate that. In terms of the science, how do I feel it's been operated in terms of compliance? We have a significant compliance presence there. The men are actually feeling particularly intimidated by it because we have a very good record of the compliance in the Clyde. And as I think it was Simon that pointed out, it was actually our association that led on the cod box and led on the no-take zone in the Clyde. So we're very compliant fishermen. We're very concerned about the science. In terms of what I think we might need for the science, I mean, I think I sent in a report explaining that the biomass is four times higher in the Clyde to what it was a number of years ago. But the science is absolutely essential because we've got issues with predation. Cod will never probably recover. There's temperature issues in terms of where it moves, but also if we've got massive predation issues with pelagic stock, with four times what it used to be, they eat the eggs. We have skate, we have dogfish, we have various things that we are calling out for science on. Our fishermen helped work with Marine Scotland and St Andrews University, who I hope are giving evidence today, to do the only Clyde trawls that we actually have to have an idea where the spawning could potentially take place. But I think Simon's right, that could isn't strong enough a word. I do think that all fishermen have been impacted by this because the stress of it has been quite unbelievable. If you've been through Brexit, COVID, everything else that's happened, the mobile men have lost ground. Some of the static men can't fish at all. So in terms of basing that on a could, I don't think that's strong enough. And I think from our part as an organisation, we want to do the absolute best we can to help support that science and going forward. But we really have to have it, because we're the forgotten coast and we're going to end up with no fishing in that area.
Thank you. Rachel Hamilton.
It's just developing Alan's questions. But the question is, what is your assessment of the evidence, the reasoning, the process and the science that underpinned the prohibition proposals that led to the Scottish Government removing the exemptions on the Clyde? And if you could give examples to develop this, that would be fantastic. I'll start with Bally.
Yeah, I think very good question. I think the whole process has been quite diabolical. I think, you know, that it's hard to argue that it wasn't anything but as far as sort of the evidence and the reasoning goes, I think that it really lacks a swell. So, you know, my understanding is that the cod box was put in place 20 odd years ago with the exemptions essentially in place from the day one. So, I mean, I think any reasonable person would have seen that it was destined to fail. Whether or not you can recover cod at all is an interesting question. Whether or not you can recover any of the fish that have declined, because we must understand that most of the previously targeted fish species in the Clyde have the same fate as the cod. They're essentially commercially extinct. There are some other species which have in turn replaced them, like Elaine mentioned, the dogfish and biting and such like, have filled the ecological niches that the other fish species which have disappeared occupied. I think, you know, what we've seen here was a very crass knee-jerk reaction from Marine Scotland to an overwhelming consultation response which critiqued the failures of the cod box to achieve what it said it was going to achieve in the first place. And I think that the rationale for it is seriously lacking. The process didn't involve the stakeholders properly. So there's this thing called the business and regulatory impact assessment process. There's a toolkit for it online, and it explains how Marine Scotland or how any government agency should go around looking at policy options. And, you know, the first thing they should do is identify the rationale for the intervention. I don't think they started at the beginning. I think they started halfway through this process. There should be analysis of what the market failure or the failure of previous policy should be, and what is the evidence base for developing the policy. I mean, that's right at the beginning. That's the opening sort of paragraph of the business and regulatory impact assessment process. And I don't think that was done. I think, you know, I'm no scientist here, but my understanding is that the whole Clyde ecosystem is a substantially modified ecosystem. And that if we want to look at cod recovery, you've got to look at it in the context of, well, you've got to start with the question of, well, what happened to the cod? And we haven't even asked that question yet. My understanding, and again, I'm no scientist, is that the use of extensive use of mobile gears in the Clyde over nearly I think it's certainly since the 3-mile limit opened in the 80s and before that in the 60s when the outer Clyde was opened, substantially modified the habitat and the ecosystem, and that it may not even be possible to recover the Clyde without attempting to recover the whole Clyde ecosystem. And therefore, having a sort of knee-jerk reaction based around, I think Marine Scotland called it disturbance, that was the word they used. They said they didn't want the cod to be disturbed, but I've yet to see any sort of evidence from Nature Scott suggesting that if you stop disturbing cod, suddenly they would bound back in the Clyde. You know, I mean, I know I'm flitting about here from Political Post, but my point is, I think that the whole process was a farce right from the beginning, even right from the point of nobody has identified exactly what the objective of the measures is, or if we can measure the output. You know, from what I've seen of the science, we could ban all fishing in the cod box and then have no reasonable way of measuring whether or not that succeeded. And from what I understand, there's a lot of scepticism from within the fishing industry and the scientific community that it's even possible to succeed in recovering cod using this mechanism. So I would have thought they should have started with asking the question, what happened to the cod? What can they do about it? And what does the science and evidence say should be done about it? So everything that's derived from this failure right at the beginning is just a farce, to be honest with you. I don't see there's any credibility in the process or in the science or in the procedure. Or in the evidence for doing what we're doing.
Okay, can I ask Elaine the same question? Do you want me to repeat it?
No, I think I remember it. I think the main issue here, the rationale, the process has been incredibly confusing. I mean, I think the fact that we're sitting here discussing this on the 2nd of March and it's been in since the 14th of February is testament to that in terms of how the stakeholders feel. I think we're moving into the area of managing fisheries by campaigning as opposed to by data and science and process. And I think that's a very worrying precedent. Bally had mentioned whether the trawl fisheries have had impact. I think, to be honest with you, we need science to prove whatever is happening in the area, but we have got a lower than 1% bycatch, which I believe is the lowest bycatch, and I think it was in the EU. Our fleets are very, very selective. They've got 300 square metre panels to make sure that we are not catching fish. So that's one thing we do have observed trips on. But I think the science that we have on baseline stocks is very, very poor. And Bally is right. What are we going to consider the improvements with? If we close this area, how are we going to compare it with what's happening before? We have very limited survey about what was happening before. And I think we can't be comparing it to, I mean, the science that we do have in terms of whether there's a rationale for it or not. I think there's the NIF report that's went in, speaks about Gonzalez and Arata and Wright as well. But we're comparing it to the North Sea, we're comparing it to Iceland. It's a very different type of fishery. We should definitely be looking to what's happening in Northern Ireland and how they've engaged their fishermen and their cod flocks, and how they've actually tried to develop a system that would offer the right protections and monitor the science continually. In terms of actually, you know, I think as well it's really important to say that the initial consultation, the indication, the preference from Marine Scotland was a rollover of what has happened for the last 20 years. Because we are going through a review of how we manage fisheries. So I think for this year, it was very misleading to a lot of the consultants, the people who would have consulted on it or responded to it, who felt that it was going to be a rollover. So they didn't know any of this was coming. It was a complete blindside. We're told it fits in with the Butte House Agreement agenda. And we need to know what's happening. Bally had mentioned the BREA. Yes, we should actually have very detailed socioeconomic analysis of what this will mean to small communities as well. As I said, we're talking about very small boats here. Even the mobile fleet, it's a small mobile fleet. We're not talking about industrial trawlers. These communities are so reliant. And those free boats that I'm talking about now that have absolutely no income, nobody's considered them at all. You know, there's been no compensation. So I really think rationale, engagement is absolutely essential, as is science. We can't keep forgetting about this area. If I can just give a practical example, I think we had a scallop survey done about 2.5 years ago, which was actually only the result of a cancelled pelagic survey in the North Sea, which allowed some science in the West Coast to prove, actually, it showed that we have some very healthy stocks in the Clyde and scallops. It's a different area, but it gave us a far better idea of what was happening, and only because it was a cancelled survey from the North Sea. Now, we need to actually just have reliable data sources, and I think fishermen are willing to help in any way that they can to work with neutral sciences in the government to make sure that we don't have processes like this. It's blindsided people, it's lost trust, and it's just, I can't justify it. Thanks.
Short supplementary, Jim Fairley.
Yeah, thank you very much, and I'd like to thank the panellists for coming along. I'm sure that there's clearly a lot of very strong feelings here. I'm just trying to get my head around. There seems to be an awful lot of competing pressures on the cod box. There seems to be lots of different types of boats going out there. So how do we get the balance right in order to allow the three boats that you're talking about, Elaine? And I have to say, I'm more concerned that we don't have the government scientists here to answer this, because clearly these people have got issues that they want answered by the government scientists.
That's your question. We've not got a lot of time.
So how do we get the balance? How do we get the balance in the future for all the competing pressures that we see, whether it's on cod, whether it's on creelers, or whether it's on trawlers? How do we balance it?
Simon, would you like to come in on that?
Yes, I think, I mean, with the science, there needs to be quite a comprehensive analysis carried out in the area as to why the cod numbers aren't there. And I wouldn't necessarily put the blame at the door of the fishermen. In fact, I would say that the fishermen are way down the food chain when it comes to apportioning any blame for lack of cod in the area. As Elaine rightly pointed out, I mean, the trawl nets are fitted with escape panels, so the cod are not getting trapped. Creels, well, for nephrops in particular, the eyes of the creels are quite small, so you tend not to get too many cod getting in there. It's very, very low in the catch. But I would look at the likes of the predators, in particular the spur dogs, which are becoming more and more prolific in the area, and they are voracious predators indeed. And I think that is the area where we really have to concentrate the science on to establish just exactly you know, where the issues are lying. I am very concerned for the smaller vessels as well, particular lobster boats where they're fishing very close to the shore, and they have absolutely zero income, you know, until the closure is lifted, and you know, I worry for their future.
It's John. Would you like to come in on this one?
Hi there. I stated at the start there, or I should have stated at the start that it's just myself as a fisherman in the Galloway Static Gear Association that's been affected, kind of thing like. And I just, as Elaine and that said, there's no strong evidence or no evidence at all to say that closing this area, that it's actually going to work like. So that's quite worrying, like, you know, and I would like to see something like that happening, like. But I just don't know. But kind of putting all the boats into the same area to fish, it's not what I would like to see neither, like, because I think we'll get gear conflict, which I think was mentioned before, and obviously, is it going to recover? And just back to what Simon said and Elaine with the predator spur dog, but my worry is, as well, is the seal population out there. It's there's seals everywhere, and they've got to eat something as well, like, so it's pretty worrying in that too. But no, just we need evidence, like, because obviously we're putting men out of jobs at the moment, for what I can see, like.
Okay, Jenny Minto.
Thank you, convener. Am I on? Can you hear me? Yes. Just a very quick question, really, just to expand on some of the evidence that Elaine and Bally have given. You've both referenced how fishermen can support the science. Can you give some specific examples? And also, if you could expand a bit on the work that's happened in Northern Ireland as well. Thank you.
Elaine, would you like to kick off?
Yes, of course. Yeah, I mean, obviously, I think we have structures in place, and somebody had mentioned about conflict and how can we resolve it by getting the science right. We have IFGs so that we can engage as fishermen, and we also have IFMAX and FMAX so that we can engage as a multidimensional stakeholder group so that everyone from the NGOs to fishermen can engage. Those are the right forums to be talking about how we take science forward. Obviously, I explained that we had done some very limited trials working with Marine Scotland and working with St Andrews University. It was a very, very useful exercise, but very limited. We can do these things, minimum resource. If you look at what they do in Norway, they have a reference fleet and they work with their fishermen to monitor everything from temperature to spawning grounds, which means that they can actually close a spawning area for 3 weeks and open it back up again and be that reflexive. I mean, that would be my ideal. We get to a point where we're actually working together. My concern is there's been a real loss of trust, and we want to try and rebuild that as quickly as possible. We don't want to be in the opposite end of the table from our government. Or we want to be working with our government and scientists and our fellow fishermen. And I think the best way is to look at what they've done in Northern Ireland, continual assessments, working with your fleet and working with really good neutral scientists. We need to stop making policy on campaigns. We need to start working together on sensible facts.
Simon.
Yes, I mean, another point in that as well, which was raised there, Sean brought in about the predation with steels. And now the two types of seals we have in the Clyde, you've got the common seal, Phoca vitrulina, and the grey seal, Helichorus gryphus. And they need between 5 and 9 kilos of fish per day to keep them going. So that accounts for a lot of fish stock in the area as well. That's on top of the spur dog, which we've already discussed earlier, which is a voracious predator as well. This really is an area that science has to consider and look at very closely. Government has the powers to turn around and say, right, okay, we're closing off the fishery for the area. You can't catch anything there. But try telling the seals and try telling the dogfish that doesn't work. We have to look at the actual problem below the waves to establish where the issue is coming from.
Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, panel. We've heard in some of the answers to questions this morning, and also we heard in responses to the call for views, concerns about the decision-making process and decisions being made without consultation, without much warning, and also being inconsistent with policy commitments. So I'd be interested in the panel's view on what impact this has had on trust, which Elaine referenced just now. So what impact has this had on trust in decision-making and collaboration between government and industry on fisheries management? And as a consequence of the handling of this order, how do you think fisheries co-management across Scotland might be impacted in the future?
Kick off with Elaine and then Alistair.
I don't think it's any secret that the Scottish Cool Fishermen's Federation... Oh, sorry, was that myself?
No, go for it. Continue. Yeah, it's fine.
I don't think it's any secret that the Scottish Cool Fishermen's Federation are quite contemptuous of existing policies or the failure to implement existing policies and rules and regulations. And we have very, very little confidence in Marine Scotland in their existing fisheries policy and their facilitating of it. And I could just give you one quick example. It's a little bit retrospective, but in 2014, the Common Fisheries Policy was amended. It was meant to be a revolution in the way we do fisheries policy, and introduced something called Article 17, which said that member states should give preferential access to fishing opportunity based on social, economic and environmental criteria. And at that point, we thought, brilliant, we're going to see the lowest impact years getting the first shout out fishing opportunity. That's exactly what the Common Fisheries Policy intended to achieve. We lobbied Marine Scotland for the better part of the next 6 years, and we never got one example of this policy being implemented, even though it was EU law. And now that we are transitioning through the Brexit process, the UK legislation has introduced something called Section 25 of the UK Fisheries Act, and it says that the administration should seek to incentivise the use of selective fishing gear. And we're seeing not a single example of this kind of thing. So if this was applied in the Clyde like it should have been, we would have seen preferential access to fishing opportunity allocated to those gears which didn't catch cod, which substantially, didn't interfere with the cod's population. So you would have seen diving and keeling not being impacted by these measures at all, and you would have seen dredging and trawling being impacted more so. And in fact, what we're seeing is the exact opposite. What we're seeing is that the creel boats are suffering the most, even though they're the least in contributing to the impacts here. So as far as our confidence in Marine Scotland and the process goes, this is just one more example, as far as we are concerned, of a long list of examples of Marine Scotland failing to implement existing policy or legislation competently.
Helene White.
Yeah, I think to go to Beatrice's question, you saw what happened when this order was made. We saw the SFF come out and make a statement. We're not part of the SFF. You saw CIFA partners make statements. You saw Shetland make statements about the concern about how we take co-management forward. Now, I would say that we have worked incredibly hard with Marine Scotland, and we want to keep that relationship going. We don't want to see it disappearing. We want to fix this. Although this has been, in our view, handled correctly. But if we can't work with our regulators, we're in a terrible position. I think that I made the point that the Clyde Fishermen's Association is one of the only areas where we piloted the no-take zone, working with the NGOs. We piloted the cod box. It almost, and we're one of the most selective gears in terms of the 300 square metre panel, etc. We're not catching cod. So it seems as if no matter what we do, actually the good work that we do may be penalising our area. And what I'm concerned about, the message that that sends out, let's not try and do something in case it gets taken out of context. Now, I think Bally was just talking there about catching, who's catching cod. As I said, mobile gear's not catching cod. Neither is the static in any great way at all. But this is about spawning. And I think this is one of the main issues that we have about understanding what we're talking about in terms of policies. This is about spawning cod. And this is actually what's causing the confusion between fishermen as well. They think maybe one type of gear's got preferential treatment over the other, etc. It's not. You have to understand, if this is about spawning, let's justify why it's about spawning and if that affects any gear or all gears. I just think the whole process has certainly undermined trust. And I am concerned about that, but I want to get it back on track. And we need neutral science. We need to move away from people not understanding the policies and running on campaigns. And we need to start getting baseline science. And our door is open to help with that in any way that we can.
A short supplement from Alistair Allen.
Thank you. A question for Simon. Clearly, the government has moved its position on this and moved its position to some extent towards, or at least taking account of, what's been put to them by fishing interests. So can I ask, what it is that you would advocate the government should have done that they didn't do, and how would they have done this in a way that would have protected, in your view, cod spawning?
Right. Well, the process was done rather rapidly, as I stated right at the beginning of the session, that I've been informed just the evening before from the Director of Marine Scotland about the announcement that was going to be forthcoming in the morning, announcing the Clyde cod spawning closure, and also advising me that all the exemptions had been removed. So it left me, a matter of a few hours to sort something out, which really is not sufficient time. And that was coming up to a weekend. A meeting was arranged for the Monday morning with various stakeholders and Marine Scotland. Bally was in attendance at it as well, and Elaine and myself. So it did not leave a lot of time. We had been preparing ourselves for the worst case scenario where the closure was going to be total. And hence the reason this meeting we had was to try and give an understanding of the ground which the cod would be likely spawning on, as opposed to the ground which they wouldn't be, which should remain open for fishers. It is a little bit selective in the fact that it affects really more the nephrop fishery as far as the opening of the ground. But the cod fishermen, crab fishermen are still caught in this area where there is a total closure. It's an impossible situation to please everybody all the time. But it has happened very rapidly. There has been a certain amount of confusion initially because the exemptions would be there, then they weren't there, and now they're back again. So it has damaged the faith and confidence that people have in the likes of Marine Scotland, the IFGs, and with Elaine as well in the Clyde Fishermen's Association. And this is something which we really do have to work on to repair, to get the confidence back. And we are here to try and establish the situation and get everything back on track.
Okay. Mercedes.
Yes, thanks. Just a quick question for Simon, if that's okay. Earlier on, I thought you seemed to suggest that rather than fishers, it was it's predators that are having the biggest impact on stock, cod stock. But the research that I've seen from Marine Scotland, and I think it was in conjunction with the European Commission,
stated that a drastic reduction of juvenile whiting bycatch is necessary for the stocks to recover, and that predation from grey seals had little impact overall. So I wondered if you could share the evidence for your statement with the committee.
Yes, can I ask you when that report was written?
It was published 2019, February.
Right. I mean, things move rapidly just now. We have, as we all know, we have climate change, water temperatures are changing. Fish move accordingly, and there have been reports, recent reports, of more particular spur dogs in the area as well, and as I said earlier, voracious predators. And seals as well, I'm hearing all the time that right up and down the west coast there is an increase in the number of seals, both grey seal and common seal.
Thank you. A short supplementary, Jim Fairley.
Yeah, so thank you. Simon, it's for yourself. What other measures should we be taking to protect the cod stocks?
Well, I think we've pretty much covered. We need the scientific evidence. We need to look at the predation side of things, and we need to get an up-to-date assessment on cod numbers. We need to look at all the different factors that affect the cod. Noise is one thing as well. I remember 30, 40 years ago, at the old Torrey Research Centre in Aberdeen, and having this very, very well illustrated and shown to me that noise and vibration on the ground is a big factor that does affect the cod. I'm not a scientist, and I don't pretend to be, but I observe, and I take these things on board, and I listen to them, and I make notes on them, because there comes the day when you will need that information, and here is the day.
Thank you. Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you to the panel. I do sense a lot of frustration from you this morning in regards to not just the science that's been disputed, but also the process in which, Marine Scotland followed. So I would just like to ask you, in terms of the science, why are you disputing that? What evidence do you have that is disputing that? And in terms of the process, when there is that science there, what action do you think should be taken when the science is showing, a particular situation which needs action? So it's just really to drill down on what is it, that you're disputing here, and what process perhaps would you have done differently from Marine Scotland if using your evidence? Thank you.
If we kick off with Alistair and then go to Elaine.
I think from my point of view, I may be on a different perspective than the other guys. We exclusively represent creelers and divers, and so we're not really so much concerned with, or we don't understand the detail of what concerns Elaine or Simon with seals or trawl bycatch. My particular argument on the science is that it just wasn't used. There was no science. That it should have started with a SNH or Nature Scot making a recommendation. There's a group called Clyde 2020, which was convened by Richard Lockhead to look at how they could recover the Clyde ecosystem and bring it into good environmental status. And they've submitted a very extensive contribution here. I think you're going to hear from the author of that later on, so I'll leave him to speak for himself. But I mean, that makes recommendations and explains what can be done. So my position on the science is this: just that we're not using it, and that there is no process described as to how we're going to evaluate the outcome of this afterwards. So from that point of view, there should be policies that we're applying here. The ecosystems-based approach. So we shouldn't just be looking at the cod when they spawn. We should be looking at the cod throughout the whole life cycle, what predates them, what protects them, what they have to eat through their various different size classes as they mature. And do the habitats exist in the Clyde that the cod need in order to thrive. And so from our point of view, we're going about this completely wrong. We should start with some scientific advice, and then we should apply the policies and the processes that are in place, like the ecosystems-based approach, and apply the spirit of Article 17, which is give preferential access to selective gear that doesn't impact cod as much. And we should transition the fishing industry towards a lower impact fishery, not just for cod, but for the whole of the inshore ecosystem. So from my point of view, that would be the scientific approach, and we're just not taking it.
Elaine?
Yeah, I mean, I think the first thing I would say is operation in silos and not having baselines. I think that's really causing a problem, because you've heard everyone here talk about gate, dogfish, seals, predation. I think I'd said the biomass in the Clyde is four times higher than it was in the 1949. This is the last science, which was done 13 years ago on that. That was the last report on that. So, I mean, the fishermen on the ground are saying that there's a change in the ecosystem. But without the science to show what's changing, it's very difficult to do anything about it. So what I would say is baseline science, we need to have that. We need to do what Norway's doing. We need to do what Ireland's doing. We need to work with our fishermen on the ground through IFGs, through associations, however we do that, that has to happen. I do think as well, I am pretty sure that later on in this meeting, there's going to be misunderstandings of what the actual process was, because if I misunderstand sometimes what the dates were, why we were doing something. I mean, this is really about spawning. And I am pretty sure that later on in this session, we will hear people not understanding that or coming at it from their own angles. We all have our own angles. And we all here to represent different people. But as Bally said, it has to be about the science. And we don't have that. And whilst we don't have that, we're subject to bad decisions. I mean, we've saw this compared to things like the North Sea scheme, cod closure. You can't compare it. We don't have a cod fishery in the Clyde. We don't have one. We don't have a targeted fishery. We lost eight boats in trying to do... Eight whitefish boats were lost to the Clyde because we wanted to do this closure. It was a massive hit. And I think the thing is, we always assumed there would be monitoring, and there wasn't monitoring. And so we don't have any whitefish boats anymore. But, you know, in the North Sea, they've got intensive monitoring. They've got sampling. You can close areas off quite quickly. They will sample what's happening. It's not happening. We maybe don't need it to happen to that level, but we certainly need it to happen. In terms of what we think we could do differently with the process, sitting with the stakeholders, have a 12-week consultation. Let everybody have their voice. Let every sector have their voice. But then let's go back to the science, and let's work together to make that science. And what I would say is, please, please, if I can say one thing, comparative science is important. Baseline science is important. Campaigning, and it's all coming from different angles, is not what we should be concentrating on. We should be understanding what the policy is there for. And if it's about recovering cod, if we're never going to recover cod because there's different stocks coming in, these things we have to have a basic understanding of, or we'll always get into this mess.
Thank you. A brief supplementary from Mercedes and then Alistair Allen.
Thank you. Just a quick question in response to Elaine's calls for more science. I understand that a study was undertaken by the Scottish Oceans Institute and the Clyde Fishermen's Association, and that found, or early results from the study showed that the presence of spawning cod in the closed area during the closure period, which suggests that the closure is in the right place at the right time. So I was just wondering if Elaine could share with us where specifically the cod are spawning according to that research, and when that research is going to be published in the public domain, so that we can all see it.
Yeah, I think this touches on the confusion. This wasn't done by the CFA. It was done in collaboration and partnership with the CFA, with St Andrews University and Marine Scotland, because we would never do any science without Marine Scotland, because we are very subject to campaigns, and we want to make sure that we're seen to be neutral. So in terms of the three reports the four reports that were done, actually, they were with St Andrews University, and I believe they will be being published shortly. It's not to do with the CFA. We have nothing to do with the science. We just let them use our vessels. So in terms of how long it's been published, we've been asking every single year since 2018 to get these trials back on place and to have it published. We've got no issue. The initial reports were published, but they were signed off of the scientists in Marine Scotland. Due to COVID and Brexit, there's been a delay in that. And so it's not been public, but it's nothing. And this is another thing about campaigning. We are getting a lot of people saying, oh, the CFA are withholding information, or they know. We haven't said anything about the report. We've not said anything. That report will just say what it says, and it will be up to every stakeholder to take out of it what they can. we haven't identified, we are not saying that there's any evidence in there that suggests that there's definite fawning in a certain place and that will be consistent for the next few years. And what you must remember is these reports are from 2018. They'll already be out of date, probably. So I think Mercedes, you've just touched on why I have a concern, because we have been attacked for the last few weeks over these reports that we're withholding, and we know where spawning has happened. We don't. And we don't say that these reports say anything. That would be up to the scientists to say that, and they haven't been signed off yet. So hopefully they are soon.
But so you haven't actually seen the report yourself?
I've seen the report, but I won't make an assessment on what it means, because this is what I'm saying. This is about baseline science. And I can't release anything public until Marine Scotland and St Andrews University sit down and they agree what's there. It's basically a presentation of facts. But in terms of the correlation about where the spawning takes place and does it take place irregularly and does it mean that this is in the right place, I can't assess that. And I don't think these reports can, because they're very minimal. It's just scratching the surface.
So in as far as it's a presentation of facts, as you've just said, CFA supports the report. You don't have any issues with it when it is published.
It's not about supporting or not supporting. This is about presenting baseline facts to people and actually trying to identify a trends in a longer period of time, which we don't have. If we do a 5-day survey, does that prove once a year for 3 years and it's already from 2018, does that prove that the cod is spawning in specific areas? I don't think it can. It's up to the scientists to say that, but what I'm saying is we need more intense science. I think the only exercise that this has really been very productive in achieving is getting fishermen to work with scientists to learn how they do it, because it's been very minimal. Would I say that it proves one thing or the other? No. I think we need more science, and it's what we've said since the start.
Okay, Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener, and I appreciate you're not going to thank me for making this point, but we've just heard a call there for us to hear more about what the official science is and what the scientific data is. It's very difficult for us to have a discussion in this committee meeting today to argue those points. Let me finish, Convener.
Alistair, we discussed this earlier and it was a committee decision. Mr. Allen, could you please stop? Science. Thank you. We already discussed this morning and we took a decision and we've heard it 3 times already. Time is very short. I don't think it needed to be put on the record again. I think we've come to the end of the session. If there's any other questions, we'll briefly suspend until 10:30 for changeover of witnesses. Thank you. Welcome back, everyone, and a welcome to our meeting, our second panel. Our panel is maybe a bit of exaggeration, but we're delighted to have Professor Michael Heath from the University of Strathclyde with us. Unfortunately, we were unable to get any other academics to appear this morning due to time constraints. So we've got approximately 25 to 30 minutes to ask some questions, and I'll kick off. So what does current scientific evidence tell us about the main factors impacting cod spawning in the Clyde and the wider marine ecosystem health?
Where to start? So factors affecting cod spawning, a bit difficult to tell in the Clyde, to be honest. So cod prefer temperatures of 5 to 7 degrees centigrade in which to spawn. So that's based on evidence from around most of Northwest Europe. The temperatures in the Clyde are rising. So in the 1960s and 70s, the minimum temperature in the Clyde was between 6.5 and 7 degrees. By the 2000s, the minimum temperature each year was 7.1 degrees centigrade. So the temperature conditions for spawning are becoming less favourable in the Clyde, that's for sure. The numbers of cod are declining based on the limited survey evidence that we have, and the catches of cod by the commercial fishery have declined. So in the 1970s and 80s, the annual catch was about 1,000 tonnes in the Clyde. By 2005, the commercial catch, commercial landings, I should say, was zero. So both the numbers and the environmental conditions for spawning are getting worse.
Thank you. We'll move straight on to a question from Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Convener. I'm interested to hear from you what other measures could be taken to protect spawning cod, Professor Heath.
Well, I think we need to look at history a little bit here. And the original rationale for the cod box closure back in 2001 was to reduce fishing mortality on cod. And that's really clearly stated in the written evidence to support that. I mean, there was an EU working group in 2007 that reviewed fishing closure areas all around Europe. And there was a large section in that report on the Clyde cod box. It was very clearly stated that the purpose of the closure was to reduce fishing mortality. And the reason for that was that as cod stocks declined in the Irish Sea, then trawlers from Ireland were coming to the Clyde to catch spawning cod in March and April. And that area of the cod box in the Clyde is a really important spawning area for cod regionally in the Irish Sea and the southwest Scotland generally. So a very large proportion of the cod catch in the 1980s and 90s in that region came from that one icy statistical rectangle, which represents the closure box, and mostly in March and April when spawning was taking place. So that was the original purpose of the closure, to protect them from fishing mortality. The new measures have shifted the goalposts, and they talk about the protection of cod from disturbance, and that's something quite different. The rationale there is to try and increase egg production. And that's based on the hope that you'll get more recruits, more young of the year coming through into the stock. And that's the science for that is completely lacking. There's no scientific justification for that shift in the goalposts or the rationale for the closure. So the withdrawal of the exemptions for boats, for fishing gears that don't catch spawning cod is justified in terms of increasing egg production. There's no evidence that that's going to carry through to increased juveniles.
So my question was, what other measures could be taken?
Well, it's clear that in terms of locally in the Clyde, the cod box hasn't had the desired effect of recovering the cod stock. So what are the measures? Well, you have to look for what the other sources of mortality are, and we've heard about predation, and that may be the case, but that's not a lever that we can pull in terms of fisheries management. The other remaining source of mortality on cod, which we can influence, is the bycatch in the Nephrops trawl fishery. And the Nephrops trawl fishermen have made huge efforts to reduce that in recent years, and they've really gone a long way. But it still remains that the bycatch of cod in the Nephrops trawl fishery is about 100 tonnes a year. Now that, based on Marine Scotland and SFF observer sampling data, and that represents less than 2% of the total biomass catch by those trawlers. So it's, you know, within the regulations that they can do that. Nevertheless, that 100 tonnes represents 2 million fish. So, you know, the average size of the fish that are caught in that bycatch is 15 centimetres, and they're about 46 grams. So 100 tonnes is 2 million fish. So a very rough estimate of how many cod there are in the Clyde is about 3.5 million fish of all sizes, from the very smallest to the very biggest. So 2 million fish in bycatch is a very significant fraction of the total cod stock. And I think if we had to look at a management measure that we could address to go beyond the effectiveness of the spawn enclosure, it would have to be that. Now, how we do that without detrimental effects on the very important Nephrops trawl fishery is another matter. I think we have to be really creative about how that can be done in terms of where and when and how we fish.
Yeah, supplementary from Aran Burgess.
Thank you. Thanks, Professor Heath, for kind of giving us the bigger picture. I wanted to just kind of dive in a little bit more detail there. You were talking about predation and bycatch. Is there any evidence that aquaculture and its side effects, including sea lice and pesticides, have an impact on cod populations?
I think I can say there's no evidence about the relationship between cod and aquaculture, no.
Go on.
Is that because there's no because we've not done any research in that area?
That would be right. Yes.
So that's maybe something worth looking at, seeing as we are hearing this morning about the kind of fluidity, to use a water word, the fluidity of the nature of the Clyde area that we're discussing and the changes that are happening there.
Yeah, I mean, I think you could make a case for researching the relationship between cod and aquaculture. You could also make a case for researching the relationship between the habitat for juvenile fish, juvenile cod, seagrass beds and the sensitivity of them, and the need to reinforce and protect seagrass beds in the and areas of inshore habitat that are very, very important, essential fish habitat for juvenile cod. There are many aspects that we could research, yes.
Yeah, and that seems like we need to be going that direction, so I'm just going to take that a little bit further and into that kind of bigger picture. The Joint Fisheries Statement will require Scotland to develop more fisheries management plans, but in your view, does Scotland need an overarching fisheries management plan to address systemic pressures on fish stocks and marine ecosystems and bring about a just transition to sustainable fisheries? And if so, what should be the key principles within that plan? Big question, but I would really appreciate hearing your perspective.
There's certainly an overarching need for a more ecosystem approach to the way in which we manage fisheries. But the science to support that is going to be very expensive. We need very strong baseline studies and a clear strategy for measuring the effectiveness of the measures that we take. It needs to be a bit experimental, I think. And there isn't a clear answer to, you know, what's the one thing we should do. It's going to vary from area to area. It's going to vary enormously from between the North Sea and the west of Scotland. They're completely different systems in terms of geomorphology and sedimentology and fisheries economics and species and everything. So it's a great ambition to have something like that, but very expensive to implement. And, you know, to be fair to the guys in Marine Scotland Science, they're extremely short of resources, as we all are.
Thank you for that.
My apologies. I may have cut Jenny Minto off before she finished her line of questioning. Okay. How you finished? Okay. Jim Fairley.
Thank you, convener. I just want to go back to something you said at the start of this. You said there is no way to mitigate, I think you said pull the trigger, on predation, and yet the previous panel, we've heard an awful lot about predation of dogfish and various other things, as well as seals. So are you saying that, and if you've got 2 million young cod being taken out by nephrod nets, are you saying that there's no way back for cod in the cod box?
Oh, the cod box is an ephemeral thing. So the thing about cod is that they congregate in very specific areas, the spawn, and they've done that for centuries. You know, these areas are very, very long established. So the cod will gather into the cod box area from much wider area than the cod box. And they'll use that area to spawn and then disperse again. So the cod box is to protect these very, very dense aggregations of cod, which it's like taking a rifle to the zoo. You know, they're so dense and it's so easy to catch them in that cod box that they attract fishing boats in unless there's some regulation to prevent that happening. And that's why the cod box is there, is to protect these very dense ephemeral spawning aggregations at a particular time of year. So the question about why the cod, how the cod are affected when they're not in the spawning cod box, during the rest of the year, when they've dispersed out into the wider area of the Clyde and indeed the North Channel, the Northern Irish Sea, is a different question. That's not covered by the cod box. That's where we need to think about other measures that may be needed to protect cod, such as habitat enhancement for juvenile fish, looking more closely at the issue of bycatch.
Yeah, that was kind of where I was going to next. What are you suggesting that they actually do? Because just taking up what you said about the nephrop bycatch, that's a huge amount of fish. If there's only 3.5 million fish in the cod box and they're taking out two million of them every year. So what do we do to protect the cod?
No, I didn't say there were 3.5 million in the cod box.
My apologies,
I misunderstood. 3.5 million in the Clyde.
In the Clyde, right, my apologies.
In the Clyde, so that includes the very tiniest ones to the very biggest fish. The spawning fish, we don't have a very good estimate of the stock, real stock in the Clyde. There just aren't the data there. There hasn't been the attention to the Clyde as a focus to gather enough data to do a good stock assessment. But sort of back of the envelope calculations suggest there might be 100,000 actual mature spawning cod in the Clyde. Out of the 3.5 million perhaps fish that cod that there are in the Clyde, the rest are all immature fish. But the vast majority of the fish are immature. And then there's these very few, perhaps 100,000 spawning cod. And some of those are going to the cod box. Some of the fish in the cod box will have come from outside the Clyde, perhaps from the Mull of Galloway, from the North Channel.
Okay, thank
you. So it's a very fluid situation over an annual cycle.
Can I just...
They're not staying in the same place all the time.
Can I just have some clarification? And an early response, I thought you indicated that there was potentially 2 million cod caught in Nephron as a bycatch. That would suggest that two-thirds of the whole population of cod in the Clyde is caught as a bycatch. That seems quite incredible. Is that absolutely right? So two-thirds of the total population of cod in the Clyde is caught as a byproduct, as a bycatch of the Nephron fishery?
And as a back of the envelope calculation, that's what it looks like.
Okay, thanks.
And 100 tons of cod is caught as bycatch. There's not much argument about that. It's a very small fraction of what's taken by the nephrops trawlers in terms of their total catch. But they're all very, very small fish. But, the natural mortality rate due to predation of these very small fish is also very high. So, a lot of the fish that are consumed by a spur dog and seals are these small fish. So there's an enormous predation loading on these very young fish. And quite naturally, it's not special to the Clyde. You know, the predation mortality of young cod is very high wherever you go.
Okay, thank you. A supplementary, Mercedes.
You know, the bycatch is part of this.
Okay, thank you. Mercedes.
Thank you. Good morning. So I think I've understood this right, that you're saying of the main factors that impact cod spawning, bycatch is the biggest one that we have the potential to do something about. So with that in mind, do you think spatial management can be a tool to reduce trawling bycatch? And I'm thinking about, do you think having differentiation between different types of fishing in different areas, is that a useful route to go down?
Well, the bycatch is not influencing cod spawning. Bycatch is affecting the survival of the young fish that are the products of spawning. So the cod closure box is about protecting the mature stock from fishing. The bycatch issue is about the survival of the young fish. So in terms of what we could do, then there's a clear spatial pattern in the bycatch rate. That's the number of young cod caught per trawl in the Clyde. So most of the bycatch is taken in the northern part of the Clyde, and that's where the young fish are most abundant. The southern part of the Clyde, from the sort of Arran and southwards, there's very, very low bycatch rates of cod in the Neffrotts trawls, as far as we can tell. So there are some spatial measures that could be taken. And certainly in the North Sea, there's a system in place of self-reporting by the fishing industry when they encounter high bycatch rates of particular species to warn other fishermen not to go to that area at that time. And this is it's a very reactive sort of system where the fishing industry is contributing to an alert system, if you like, that we're encountering high bycatch rates here, don't fish in this area. So there are many measures like that can be taken, I think.
Professor Heath, I'd be interested to get your take on some of the things that were said by previous witnesses. We did seem to have some scepticism put about the effectiveness of previous measures around cod on the Clyde, and also some questions raised about what could be done in the future. So it'd be interesting to have your view on the effectiveness of the measures we've had in the past and whether, in your view, there is anything that can be done in the future to protect cod spawning and protect a cod fishery in the Clyde.
Part of the problem is that the original measure, the original spawning cod closure, made no provision for the gathering of monitoring data to evaluate its success. So we really don't know how effective the cod box closure has been. So it's a sort of precautionary measure, if you like. It seems like a good thing to do. And I think that's right, that this really important spawning congregation of fish on the sill of the Clyde in the cod box is important to protect, but we have no real scientific data as to how effective that's been in protecting, conserving, recovering the cod stock in the area. And I think that's an important point, that there's no provision for monitoring of the success of the measure.
Can I also just pick up on something that other witnesses had raised, which was about spur dog? And again, you may say that you may be about to tell me there's not much science in this either. I don't know, but it would be interested to know about your view about what impact you feel spur dog might be having on the species. But there has been a debate in other parts of the West Coast, for instance, about a spur dog fishery being viable in the future. I just wonder if you can offer any observations about spur dog.
Well, spur dog are certainly very abundant in the Clyde. There used to be a fishery for dogfish in the Clyde. We don't have any data on the diet composition of spur dog in the Clyde. So it's sort of an arm-waving proposition that spur dog are responsible for the lack of recovery of the Clyde. There's no hard evidence for that.
Thank you, convener.
Jim Fairley.
Did you have us up?
you, Jim. Professor Heath, do you think that the Scottish Government decisions have disproportionately impacted one fishing method over another without the clear scientific evidence that you discuss?
Well, I can't comment on the impact on individual fisheries. That's not out of my expertise. But I don't see any evidence to support the idea that creels, for example, disturb the spawning activity of cod. That seems to be something for which there's no evidence at all.
Thank you.
Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Convener. Just on that point, from a pure layman's point of view, we heard earlier on from Simon that, and I'm just going back to the point that you've just made, about creel fishermen not having any effect on spawning at all. But he seemed to be talking about the fact that noise was a big disturber of spawning fish. I'll come back to that. What research and data monitoring do we need to have to make sure that we've got the proper evidence to be able to protect the cod recovery measures? I know it's a big question.
Well, if we go back to the original purpose of the cod box closure, it was to reduce the fishing mortality on the cod. So the measures that we would need in place to measure to monitor the success of that would be survey and sampling data, which would gather information on the numbers at age of different age classes of cod in the region, so that we could calculate the mortality rate from year to year of the cod which are caught in the spawning box. And we simply don't have those data. So there's an annual survey of the whole of the west of Scotland in March, which is conducted as part of the wider stock assessment process for all whitefish species in the west of Scotland. There's four or five trawl hauls per year conducted in the Clyde as part of that. And that's just insufficient to monitor the success or otherwise of the spawning box closure. Okay. So regarding research on the effects of noise, this is a separate question. It's about this sort of shifting the goalposts of the logic for the cod box closure towards not just protecting cod from being caught, but protecting cod from disturbance to their spawning activity. And the science to support that is completely lacking, as far as I can see, in the Clyde.
Okay, can I just come back on that then? Because to me, protecting the spawning is the same as protecting the fish from being caught, because if fish are being caught, they're not laying eggs. But if they are laying eggs and then the eggs are being disturbed, the effect will be the same, surely?
But it's not about laying eggs. It's about the survival of the fish. The original purpose was to prevent cod being caught, because ultimately the future of the stock depends on fishing mortality, on the mortality rate that's inflicted on the cod by fishing. But that's right. About the survival of the fish. The other part of the story about egg production is about promoting production of young fish, of recruits, of young of the year.
Yeah,
that's a separate bit of a separate logic.
But I understand that. But the at the end of the day, what you're trying to do is produce more young fish. If noise, as we were told earlier on, has a real pushback on allowing cod to settle, then they'll move. If they're moving, they're not laying eggs, so therefore the eggs aren't there in the first place to hatch. So therefore you're not going to get young fish to survive because the eggs were never laid. So it's understanding whether or not the shift from catching to disturbance is really such a dichotomy, or whether both of them are equal as important.
But the assumption there is that if you produce more eggs, you're going to get more young of the year.
So yeah, but the other assumption is if you move them, they're not laying eggs at all.
No, I don't think there's any evidence for that.
Well, according to the evidence we were given this morning, Noise is a problem for fish that are laying eggs. If the fish don't lay the eggs, you don't get the young. So it's a dual problem as far as I can see.
But it's not necessarily the case that if they lay more eggs, you'll get more young.
I understand that. I get that. But if they don't lay eggs in the first place, then they're not young and they're going to be there. It's a chicken and egg, isn't it?
Nobody's suggesting that they won't lay any eggs as a result of noise. There's no science to suggest that at all.
Okay. Right, well, we need to take some scientific evidence to make sure that we know what we're talking about here. I can't take away from the fact that if you get the eggs laid and the young fish hatch, they'll be predated on and we get bycatch. I understand all of that. But if the cod are being moved because of noise, then they won't necessarily... If a bird lays an egg in a nest and gets disturbed, she leaves the eggs and the eggs don't hatch. Either way, you're getting the same level of loss, as far as I can see, and I'd like to get more evidence on what the reality of that is.
I don't think you can equate spawning by cod to spawning to the egg laying by birds. So an individual female cod lays about 1 million eggs a year. And, a 60-centimetre cod in the Clyde lays about 1 million eggs a year. And it only takes two of those to survive to age three to sustain the stock. The vast majority of the eggs that are laid every year never make it to spawn again themselves. They're lost to water currents, to being eaten by plankton, to being eaten by other fish like sprats, for example. So the number that survive to make it through to being a grown-up spawning cod in the future, very, very, very tiny fraction of all those that are laid. So the small changes that you could achieve in the number of eggs that are produced as a result of reducing noise is entirely swamped by these natural processes that are affecting the survival of those eggs and the carry through to the number that become adults themselves.
Okay, so
that's their strategy. Their evolutionary strategy is to produce vast numbers of eggs on the expectation that very, very few will survive.
Thank you. Ariane Burgess. We're going to move to Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener. Finding this all really fascinating, actually, and there just seems to be this sticking point, though, in terms of data, the science. It's something we keep hearing, and there is some science there. But it is often disputed, as we heard in the previous panel as well. What would you see, within your field, the Scottish Government doing? What opportunities do you feel would be there for them to help with more future research? And how can you see that working with fishers to collaborate with the scientists in this field to improve all the research data and monitoring?
Well, I think Marine Scotland Science are doing the best they can with the resources they have available. They have a vast territory to cover in Scotland with a myriad of issues to address. And, I guess the Clyde looks, quite small on their radar in terms of some of the really big problems that they've got to face. But they have been extremely supportive of science in the Clyde from the academic sector, but it's been quite serendipitous. We've got a sort of hit list of projects that we see as important, which we've drawn up as part of the Clyde Marine Planning Partnership Research Advisory Group system. But finding for money for those is, we put in grant proposals and some get funded and some don't. And so it's a bit hit and miss as to what goes ahead. So what we're lacking is a sort of systematic sort of permanent, enduring monitoring funding system to support the gathering of data in the Clyde. But you could say the same for almost, the Moray Firth or the Firth of Forth or Shetland or Orkney or, all sorts of places around Scotland require this sort of input. And there just aren't the resources there to do it. In terms of collaboration with the industry, there are lots of opportunities for doing that, and those are being exploited. Elaine has mentioned, for example, the collaboration between St Andrews University and the Fishermen's Association in surveys there, and we'll grasp those opportunities wherever we can. I know Elaine reasonably well, and you know we get on quite well, and we've talked in the past about, for example, setting up a monitoring system for a stock assessment system for scallops in the Clyde. Again, that fell because of lack of funding. We just couldn't get the funding together in the end. So that's the bottom line, if you like, is that there just aren't the resources to support the level of activity that's needed to address all the aspirations for the marine management of the Clyde.
Okay, that's really helpful. Thank you. So you feel that more sustained, lengthy investigation, rather than perhaps only short-term gathering of evidence is needed.
Well, you might get away, I suppose, with episodic intensive activity. So, for example, if you did an intensive study every 4 or 5 years, that might be sufficient, rather than a more draining, demanding, continuous, perhaps lower level effort over many years. I think that's the strategy there needs to be thought through.
Okay, Ariane Borges.
Thanks, Convener. It's really great to get the picture of the challenges around gathering data and funding and all of that. For clearly issues not just in the Clyde but across the marine space in Scotland, for us to get a better sense of what's really going on. So thank you so much for that. And I almost wish that you had been the first panel, because I think you've given a much better context for our line of questioning. With a bit more detail, though, what are your views on the use of remote electronic monitoring in terms of the research, with cameras on fishing vessels to assist with data collection on cod recovery and on the impact of different fishing methods? And how, in your view, could the Scottish Government encourage more fishers to make use of this tool and play a key part in research and monitoring?
Well, I think new technology has got a lot of scope, both in monitoring fisheries, but also monitoring the environment. So in terms of monitoring fisheries, it would be great to have more data and work towards a fully documented fishery of what was being caught, what was being landed, what was being discarded. That would be fantastic. But there's much that we can do to have autonomous vehicles monitoring the environment, doing echosounder surveys, so hydroacoustic surveys of the biomass and the distribution of fish and plankton in the sea. So we've recently done some surveys in the North Sea with unmanned surface vessels. These are small remotely controlled vessels with scientific equipment aboard them. They can be controlled from Australia if you want by satellites. And that's a new approach to gathering data more cheaply, more continuously, I suppose, than we're able to do with big expensive ships. Lots of scope.
Thank you for that, and thank you for expanding on the potential for satellites and other things. But it's clear that we need to be moving in this direction if we want to have a successful fisheries in the future.
Yes, yeah, it all takes resources, of course, but
thank you.
It doesn't come free.
Rachel Hamilton.
I just wanted to ask you, because I had to leave the room briefly, and I'm apologies if I missed this, but we talked earlier about an ecosystems approach. And I wondered what an ecosystems approach looked like. So you balance the sustainability of cod stocks, but also combining that with the economic viability of the fishing industry. Can you cite some examples, Professor Heath, of how that has worked in the rest of the world?
Well, the ecosystem approach to fisheries is about breaking away from conducting stock assessments on a single species basis. So, for example, for decades, stock assessments in the west of Scotland and the North Sea have been done species by species. So we have a stock assessment for cod, and we have some TAC that's set for cod. We have a stock assessment for whiting, and there's a TAC set for whiting, and so on. But that doesn't recognise the fact that all these species are part of a network of who eats who and whom in the sea. So, know, everything is connected together in the sea, from the smallest plankton to the biggest whale. Eventually, they're all connected, interconnected by this network of predator-prey relationships. And the ecosystem approach to fisheries is about recognizing that everything's interconnected and that, you know, no fish species is an island. So you can extend that further to recognizing that people are connected to the sea as predators on the marine ecosystem. And that's the next frontier, if you like, for the ecosystem approach, is to treat humans as part of the ecosystem, as well as the animals and plants that live in the sea.
Thank you.
Thank you. Just one final thought. We've seen failures that have been highlighted to us in the laying of the first prohibition order. And subsequently, that order was changed and is now in place. Do you think that's led to a lack of trust from fishermen and the scientific researchers like you and whatever they're involved in this? Has it led to a loss in trust in how regulations are brought forward? And you also touched on resourcing Marine Scotland. Is the situation likely to get better unless we see significant increases in the resource that Marine Scotland has to ensure that the policies are put in place deliver what we all want to see in that sustainable fisheries and sustainable rural communities?
Well, to answer the last question first, I think resourcing of marine monitoring, marine research in Scotland is severely limiting, and the capacity to, you know, to develop state-of-the-art approaches is very much hampered by lack of resources. To go to the first part of your question, there's widespread support for the original logic of the closure box to protect cod from being caught. I think the leap in logic towards what we have recently seen in terms of trying to promote egg production in the hope of increasing the number of juveniles in the system, lack science took everybody by surprise, and, you know, has been quite unhelpful, it seems to me.
Professor Heath, thank you very much for joining us. You are very much in the spotlight, being on your own, and we appreciate you putting aside the time to answer some of these questions. Thank you very much. We'll Welcome. Briefly suspend until 11:15, where we'll have our final panel. Thank you. Welcome back, everyone, and a welcome to our meeting, our third panel, consisting of environmental NGOs. And a welcome to the meeting, Russell Cheshire, Trustee of the Community of Arran Seabed Trust, Alec Watson-Crook, Projects Manager for Sustainable Inshore Fisheries Trust, Callum Duncan, the Convener of the Marine Group, the Scottish Environmental Link, and David Nairn, Our Seas Coalition, and Phil Taylor, Head of Policy and Operations, the Open Seas Trust. We've got until approximately 11:55 for questions, and I'll ask Rachel Hamilton to kick off.
Good morning, panel. We've taken evidence that the COD box is destined to fail, and it's questionable whether the Scottish Government actions can recover COD. So can I ask the panel, does the current COD closure provide adequate protection for spawning COD in the Clyde? And I'll start off with David Nairn, please.
Question, and thanks for an opportunity to attend the meeting. And can I just start out by saying that the Our Seas Coalition isn't actually an ENGO, and it's wrongly labelled there, but it's a kind of broad and steady growing coalition of 128 members. This in the coastal businesses, community groups, fishermen's organisations, shellfish farmers, tour boat operators, and the stuff that I do, which is marine monitoring and like habitat restoration in the Clyde. So we're a kind of diverse group of people, and we're not run by a committee as such. All these members, we have a flat eye hierarchy where all these members can contribute to the organisation. And from that, we have like three main asks, and which is a transition to low impact fisheries, and a preferential access for non-destructive or less destructive fishery techniques, tracking and monitoring and all inshore vessels, and a new we see to protect marine stocks, including the cod here. We're just saying that we need a new coastal inshore limit, kind of roughly loosely based around the old 3 mile limit. But to answer your question, I don't believe, or I welcome that the new regulations for the cod box and the kind of the ethos behind it. I don't actually believe that it's going to help the long term benefit of cod in the Clyde. You know, we can't just ring mark an area in the southern part of the Clyde when we know that all the juvenile cod actually swim in the north end of the Clyde, and that the whole of the Clyde is used as a nursery area for juvenile fish. You know, we're protecting where they spawn, perhaps, in one of the cod areas off of Campbelltown. But you come up to other areas of the Clyde and we're absolutely destroying the habitat with bottom toed gear. So until we actually address all that, I think that the regulations are doomed to fail. You know, the derogations previously have, you know, there's no evidence to suggest that those derogations to allow bottom toed gear has had any effect on the cod at all. You know, and we're absolutely welcome the Marine Spatial Planning Frameworks initiative to have an ecosystem-based approach in the Clyde. And I think it's time that we recognise that, and that's got to be addressed within a kind of fisheries framework going forward.
Can I ask the same question? Thank you for that, David. Can I ask the same question, please, to Callum Duncan?
Yeah, thanks for the question. I mean, I think it's too early to say whether it's destined to fail. As the committee's heard this morning, there's so much to unpack on this issue. And just to sort of to press A before I answer the question, you know, we within the Scottish Environment Link network have consistently for many decades, you know, advocated for ecosystem-based management. That's why we advocate for the Marine Scotland Act, for there to be a marine planning system, for a well-managed MPA network. And most recently, we've set out steps that we think are needed to recover the health of the seas in our ocean recovery plan. And as part of that, we're We're emphasising the importance of ecosystem-based fisheries management as well, spatial management of fishing. We do recognise in that we think there is too high a footprint of some of the more heavy bottom gears near shore. We're very much advocating a sort of spatial approach to managing fisheries all around Scotland, but very much along the lines of what Mike Heath was saying before, that we really need to look at that kind of ecosystem-based approach, depending on what parts of the sea we're looking at. And in the Clyde, I can say that we did support a proposal for a regulating order for the Clyde, and I know that's kind of didn't go forward, because we see the success of that in Shetland. So in isolation, so the answer to the question is, I think the cod box in isolation isn't enough, but I think I very much was on the same page as what Mike was saying about there is still a role to have that cod box. And the reason it's probably, it might not have worked in the past was because it allowed exemptions for gears that potentially take spawning mature cod, but it's doing that in the context of not having other spatial measures that look at where the juvenile cod aggregate as the mass evidence highlighted and as David's mentioned there, with up northeast of Arran, up in the sea logs. So there's just very quickly to respond to some things that were said in the earlier session. We'll never have perfect science, but we have best available science, and best available science says that there is a bycatch issue in the Clyde and that protecting and enhancing critical fish habitat helps. The process for removing the exemptions for the box could have been handled better. I do understand the discussion about disturbance versus actual catch. From a precautionary approach, we were concerned about disturbance, but we think the outcome could have been much smarter, where you could have had some kind of zoned approach to give areas that creelers were confident that they could use. So this whole process identifies the or sort of highlights the concerns about a lack of that spatial framework, and that's very much what's needed going forward. So it's not destined to fail. It needs monitored, but this whole process highlights the need for that wider spatial framework.
Okay, thank you. I'm just going to check with the convener if there's time for
David Nevin would like to come in and respond to this.
Okay. Hi there. It was just when Callum said. Sorry, can you hear me? Sorry.
Called you Nevin. David Nevin is not appearing in front of us today. We've got a far better replacement in David Nairn. David, go ahead.
It was just when Callum wanted to. What we'd like to say is I live in the Clyde, right? I look out the window and I've watched three trawlers burning, rip up and down the Largs and Hunterston Channel in an area that we're trying to restore habitat. I'm actively engaged in restoring the seas out there. I'm engaged in monitoring. And when I go out, I've got lots of pictures of bycatch. I totally support Professor Heath's figures there about the bycatch amounts that are getting chucked. And that's the estimates that are probably getting reported. We watch a lot of bycatch getting chucked into the sea. But I'd also like to say I'm involved in hydroacoustic monitoring of the Clyde. And there was mentioned in the committee before that one of the reasons why to exclude the creel fishing was that they were still disturbing spawning, the lekking sites for the cod. But we have a lot of data on that that we're completely happy to offer the committee and to offer Marine Scotland, the very high resolution of the data that we have, and offer that to the committee, to Marine Scotland, and help work with Mike Heath that can actually show that these keel boats aren't producing anywhere as near as the amount of noise that the mobile sector is producing. And you've also got to remember the mobile sector is actually working on top of these lekking sites. whereas the creel sector is around, you know, these creels, that because of the spatial squeeze in the Clyde, they're pushed to the periphery. So, just, you know, we're there offering, we produce science, you know, we've had a PhD and MSc, various honours projects, and we've produced several papers on science in the Clyde. So there is science getting done by community-led organisations, but it's held aside, you know, and the scope there. But I'm just offering that to make sure that the committee are aware that that data is available to them if and when they ever need it.
Thank you. The real Phil Taylor would also like to come in. Phil.
Thank you very much, and thanks for the opportunity to talk. I just wanted to respond to Rachel's question. Is it destined to fail? Is it destined to fail? No, it mustn't fail. The legislation, which we're relying on, legislation from 67 here, to bring the statutory instrument to you guys, and that requires a justification. The justification is that the designation is used to recover cod. The government are then compelled to recover cod using this site, and that also aligns, of course, with their international commitments under Sustainable Development Goal 14, but also other commitments under the Marine Scotland Act, National Marine Plan, as well as pretty much everything the government says on these issues within future catching policy, future catching strategy. And it's, I think, really encouraging that the committee is spending so much time on this, because you are there really to hold them to account on that commitment, I think. And I personally really value that. So I just wanted to respond on that sort of technocratic issue, sorry.
Thank you. And Alex, would like to come in.
Thank you, convener. It's not destined to fail, but it will fail if Scottish Government and Marine Scotland don't move forward with some of the ideas, certainly that Professor Heath came up with earlier. And we need to push forward the communications and the stakeholder engagement to make this happen. It's really frustrating. You know, we knew about this as of 2015, that it wasn't working. The cod spawning protections weren't working in that particular form. So we've had time to think about that. That's 7 years ago. So the time is now. Drive it forwards. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to move to questions from Jenny Minto.
Thank you, convener. Really just following on from Alex's point there, I'm interested if you could give us some information as to how you thought, how the consultation progressed, but also recognising that we've got, I think, competing marine interests here. So I'm interested to hear how these can be appropriately balanced in the future and what consultation you see going forward to ensure sustainable fishing in communities. Let's start with, I don't know, Alex.
Alex, would you like to respond to that one? Alex, not hearing?
Maybe not.
Phil, can you come in and respond?
Yeah, I'll start just while Alex is getting in. So my view is that the consultation was extremely poor. I think I agree and really sympathise with some of the stakeholders we've heard from this morning about this process. I think that the suggestion that there was a sort of expectation in the initial consultation and then that wasn't followed through, that really shows a sort of a poor approach to public decision making, I think, from Marine Scotland. Because a consultation should be a consultation. We shouldn't be putting consultations on the table which we have pre-baked decisions in them. That's completely inadequate in sort of democratic terms, and we really need to push back against that, I think. In terms of how do we manage the stakeholder landscape, I think that that's a really important question, and I think, again, is one where, again, I'm buoyed by the fact that the committee is spending so much attention on this issue. And I would, you know, ask that you sort of help through part of that, because it's clear that there's a lot of contention around this stuff. It's clear that there's distrust. You know, that's across the board, I think, in all sorts of, you know, very damaging ways. We just one, for example, on the compliance issue, it was suggested that there's a very high degree of compliance in the Clyde. There was actually a case in Lamlash Bay, the no-take zone, of a fisherman pleading guilty to deploying nets in there just a couple months ago, right? This is really quite negative stuff and damaging trust. And we need politics to help us through that. I think that the inshore fisheries group structure, which provides a place for fishing to talk, but no one else to really have input. Open Seas has submitted lots of evidence, lots of requests and things to those groups over the years. Nearly all of it's been, not responded to or inadequately responded to. There's really no way for the community to engage in those kind of ways. We are an NGO, sorry, I'm not the community. We're a charity. We need better structures for that, and we need support from politicians to help create those better structures. We need a forum where stakeholders can come around. And just on the restructuring, I think it was kind of some of what Jenny was suggesting there. Sorry if I'm misinterpreting or misrepresenting, but it is worth noting that of the science that's been done in this area, of the economic socioeconomics that have been done in this area. Scottish Government published their own sort of consultants looking into the Nephrops fishery in 2020. And I've just got the numbers here in front of me. They show that if there was better spatial management of this fishery, which is ultimately what we're talking about here, right? Better spatial management of creel versus trawl, but also the management of the two of them. There would be a £6.4 million increase in GVA, and they would move from 7 creel vessels. Elaine was talking about the reduction in creel vessels earlier, from 7 creel vessels to 69 creel vessels. That's the government's own science backing up the support for a socioeconomic transition, which would also achieve some of these environmental goals. And we need to bear that in mind, that the restriction in these ways doesn't always have a negative impact on socioeconomics in the long term. It has an impact on businesses. And we need to figure out how to support those businesses in that transition, support those businesses in diversification. Of course, we're in a massive structural change with the announcement yesterday from Kate Forbes. So these kind of massive changes in economies shouldn't be something that we're afraid of, but we need politicians to help us sort of navigate that process, I believe. Thank you.
I've had Russell indicate you'd like to come in, then Alex and then Duncan. And if you could try and address the question directly, we've got five or six questions to come, so hopefully all the points you're picking up and your contributions will be covered anyway. But if you could address the actual question, that would be much appreciated. Russell.
Sorry, convenient. Thanks for the opportunity to speak. Could I just have a brief resume of what the previous question was?
So I was interested in the fact that we've got competing marine interests here and how we can appropriately balance the competing interests.
Right. Thank you for that, Jenny Winter. I think the issue there is that we're looking from a base of competing interests. The sea is a public resource. The interests should be working together with each other. At the moment, we seem to have this situation where a large sector has taken over much of the Clyde, which sounds a bit emotional, but is actually, if you look out there, most of the boats are prawn trawlers. Their catch is something in the region of 70 to 80% of what's taken out of the Clyde. Now, we've heard from Mike Heath about bycatch and the quantity of cod taking from there. If we can change the way that the fishing industry operates, so transition away from high impact bottom dragging methods to other lighter touch opportunities, then that sector will benefit, the creel sector will benefit, other people like commercial sea anglers will benefit. At the moment, we've got two or three boats in the Firth of Clyde, whereas there used to be 90-odd. It's working together, making space for each other, and we need to shift the way we're looking at the whole system at the moment.
Alec? to
another. Hello, thank you. We're on audio only, unfortunately, due to some technical issues. There are competing interests. That it's really important that Marine Scotland and Scottish Government convene appropriate stakeholder forums where these things can be thoroughly discussed, where decisions are taken absolutely with the ecosystem-based approach in mind. Here at SIFT, we have looked previously and in fact have released a couple of reports around reform of inshore management governance. And it is this governance that needs to be highlighted and considered by the committee when we think about getting the right people around the table to make the right decisions. Our most recent paper on that looked specifically at the inshore fisheries groups and, you know, the lack of engagement with other marine stakeholders and the lack of rigour in the development of the fisheries management plans by the RAFGs. I'm more than happy to share those papers with the committee following the meeting.
Yep, that would be helpful. Duncan. I beg your pardon. I'm getting my names all mixed up to you. Callum Duncan, my apologies.
No problem. Yeah, just to say, we've put a very detailed response into the future fisheries management discussion process a few years ago, where we were sort of, we had that space to think about what does the future of fishing look like in Scotland and how do we get there? And what we said in part of that discussion was it's an opportunity to actually just take stock of all the effort in Scotland, what the fleet looks like, what stocks are being targeted, and you know, and actually have a think about where you know, as a whole, you know, Scotland wants to get to in terms of a just transition to sort of climate and nature smart fishing. Further down the line, and I think it's quite hard to have that discussion, partly because of resources, partly because of structures as well. Certainly, as far as the inshore is concerned, as again Mike was touching on, and others have here, you know, you have this, you know, this vast coastline. With comparatively fewer resources, and I've made the point to a predecessor committee on this, comparing the number of you know, fisheries compliance vessels of Sussex IFCA compared to the whole of Scotland, for example. So we do look at the inshore fisheries conservation authorities in England, not that they're not without their issues, but the clue's in the name. They're inshore fisheries and conservation authorities. So I think a lot of the I absolutely endorse much of what was said in the previous sessions. I mean, this online format is a bit different from in person because we're in different sections. I would have, you know, been happy to say that in plenary. That, you know, we need the process where there isn't the distrust or there isn't the concern that you know, if there's not engagement in this area, something will happen over here. You know, there needs to be that integration. So I think there's an opportunity there with regional marine plans, reform of fisheries management, but it has to happen. It has to happen meaningfully, and resources have to be put in to do that. And I know how stretched resources are, but that is a simple fact.
Okay, thank you. And David.
Thank you. And just on the competing interests and the distrust, I think in terms of communities and keeping it local and client-centric, the communities are basically, they're not being allowed to engage within the marine spatial planning framework as such. They've been excluded from the delegate authority. And, you know, until that's allowed to happen, there's always going to be a certain distrust. And we're also, you know, it stems back, if I give you an example, during the Future of Fisheries Management workshops, we went up to Glasgow and we were basically shouted out the workshop by the fishing interests there. And there's, you know, the fisheries organisations in the cloud, they say there's an open door, come and speak to us at the IFG. They'll say that publicly, but privately, when we say, right, can we come to an IFG meeting, we're not allowed to attend. So those doors are not open. It's not, we are not operating in a silo, we are being put in a silo, and basically until something changes there, there is going to be this distrust between generally between the communities and the commercial invested interests on the cloud, which includes the mobile gear fishing. Thanks.
Thank you. Jim Fairley.
Yeah, I'm just going to move on slightly to the... do you feel that the Scottish Government were justified in the evidence and reasoning that they gave for putting in the quad box in the first place?
Maybe go to... Phil on that one, please.
Thank you. No, thrilled to have the question. Thank you. I would again point, I think one of the community raised this earlier, but the justification for the quad box is given in the consultation as the report between the Scottish Oceans Institute and the Clyde Fishermen's Association. That is the justification which was given in the consultation in October 2021, so a good number of months ago. And we have yet, that has yet to be made public. That has yet to be shared anywhere. There was a meeting with Marine Scotland where I asked if, you know, if they could share any kind of summary of it. And it turned out that the chief scientist from Marine Scotland who was there, Marine Scotland Science, who was there, hadn't seen it, but that the chief policy person had. This is very worrying, right? This is very worrying. It's completely against the Aarhus Convention on transparency around environmental decision making. But it's also very worrying in terms of just structures of government. So in terms of whether it is justified in the first instance, clearly the cod population has collapsed on the West Coast. People are very happy to talk about the Newfoundland cod collapse, but for some reason we never really talk about it in a Scottish context, despite having suffered a similar fate. So recovery action is completely justified. We need to recover that. We have legal duties to do so, as I mentioned earlier. Whether this is the right location for it or not, I simply cannot tell you, because the evidence which is being used by public authorities to justify that is not being made available to environmental groups like myself or even the public.
Thank you. No further supplement to Jim. I'll move on to a question from Alistair Allen.
Convener, throughout today, a number of witnesses have talked about what hasn't worked. But I'm keen to know what are the areas where there has been success in research that might help us build the kind of spatial planning that you've talked about. I think that's possibly a question again for Phil Taylor.
Happy to start, but I don't want to hog the space. Spatial management, you just alluded to in the question, I think is clearly the core part of it. There was some great work done by Marine Scotland Science presented to the Northwest Waters Advisory Council, which is was the EU body that sort of managed some of these fisheries, about the sort of ecosystem modelling. Mike Heath spoke about that as well. And there is a need to reduce, if we're just talking about cod, there's a need to reduce the amount of juvenile fish that killed, the mortality of the juvenile fish as they come through the age classes, trying to get to age 3 so that they can contribute back to the population. And there is a need to improve the habitat structure, which they then use both as nursery grounds to hide. They really need to hide when they're very small, so they need that seabed diversity. Seagrass is one of those habitats, there's many others, and also to forage themselves. Those kind of approaches have worked in Norway. It's kind of, I'm reluctant to always point back to Norway because it happens so much within fishing. But within Norway, you have just one example, the skrei cod fishery, which you may have heard of. You sometimes see skrei cod on restaurant menu in high-end restaurants. The big spring spawning, I can't remember if there's spring spawning. Whatever, the big cod that come in shore and they're line caught and they're treated well. The meat is treated well is the idea. And we don't have anything like that. We don't have those kind of inshore fisheries for cod like that, and it's really disappointing. It's a real opportunity. Ultimately, if we were able to recover, this cod population, it would be a good thing for the fishing fleets, communities, and for the food system around the Clyde. There is a parallel there with what's going on up north.
Russell would like to come in.
Thank you, Convener. If I could just point the committee in the direction of the Lamlash Bay no-take zone and the South Erin MPA. Research work from Dr. Elliott and others in 2016-17 has shown that juvenile gadoid, cod-like fish, cod itself, haddock, are starting to return in good numbers to those areas. And because of a lack of disturbance, because for a large part of that South Arran Marine Protected Area, all trawling is excluded, the fish have an opportunity to grow to a meaningful size, which will allow them to reproduce more healthily. The committee is probably aware that in marine life, a youngish fish of 5, 6, 7 years old might produce 100, 250,000 eggs per annum, whereas a much older fish, 18, 19 years old, could produce 1 million eggs. Now, at the moment, the chances, we've seen from Mike Heath's numbers, the chances of a fish living to 18 or 19 years of age is extremely remote. So we must implement proper fisheries management and marine protected area management throughout not just the Firth of Clyde, but the rest of Scotland. We have the Clyde Sea Sill, which covers most of what we're talking about today. That's been in place since it's designated in 2014. There's no effective marine management plan in place after 7 years. We need Marine Scotland to get a move on so that fish and the rest of the marine ecosystem can recover to a healthy, abundant, biodiverse and productive level. At the moment, we're looking at effectively a monoculture in the Clyde. It used to be much more diverse, and it's a result of overfishing, possibly industrial pollution, possibly climate change. As others have said, a lot needs to be looked at, but allowing fish like the cod to recover will be a big step on the way back to a healthy, biodiverse marine environment in the Clyde. Thank you.
Thank you. Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener. We've heard a lot about, you know, opportunities that could exist, and we've spoken about fisheries management. So what specific opportunities might exist to improve fisheries management in the Clyde through the development of a fisheries management plan? Open that up to Phil. Yeah.
Thank you for the question. I think that there's loads of opportunities. Specific policy opportunities coming down the line are, of course, the future catching policy and the joint fisheries statement. So the joint fisheries statement should set out the plans and policies that the government will take to deliver the fisheries objectives of the UK Fisheries Act. And that includes the ecosystem objective, that includes the national benefit objective, that includes the climate change objective, the bycatch objective, right? So we need to, all the building blocks are there for us to be using that policy opportunity to create a system which is better and providing public benefits and more sustainable. There is also the future catching policy, which the government have promised since the publication of the future catching strategy, one of these sort of timelines, and that was promised at the end of 2020. But that, I guess, will be coming to committee in the coming wee while. What those have the opportunity to provide for, I believe they have the opportunity to provide for a recovery. I think we need to be looking, you know, there's a 2030 strategy, so 8 years hence, opportunity for recovery of these stocks, such that we have, you know, a diverse ecosystem, which Russ mentioned there, which provides a diverse opportunity for fishing and food and enjoyment of nature. I think that diversity is really key, and as Russ said, it's really lacking at the moment.
Callum.
Thank you. Just quickly, heartily endorse looking at Norway for the insurer. And the question just asked was some of the supplementaries I was going to put in the previous one. So these policy commitments and legal consultations coming down the line, must be looked at holistically. So there's Phil's listed some. There's also the work to improve protection of priority marine features beyond the MPA network. There's also to be work starting to meet the welcome commitment for 10% of Scotland's seas to be in HPMAs. There's the commitment to cap inshore fishing and have that as a ceiling from which there's an evidence-based reduction from there. So again, the key watchword for me on this is integration. I've been in many conservation policy discussion spaces and then fisheries policy discussion spaces, and often they don't come together. So it's kind of, and that's getting better. I don't mean that as a criticism. I think we have to recognise the fisheries benefits of biodiversity protection and the biodiversity benefits of fisheries protection, and just integrate these better and try to look at these opportunities coming forward as a package to deliver that ecosystem based spatial management that we're advocating for.
Thank you. Supplementary Mercedes.
It's just a very quick yes or no question, if possible, for each panellist, starting with Alex. Do you believe there's evidence to support the banning of creeling and dive fishing along with trawling?
I think we heard it earlier from... Hello, can you hear me now?
Yes, go ahead.
Good. I think we heard earlier from Professor Heath that there is very little evidence of creeling damaging the spawning stocks. And I think this is a really important part of what went wrong with the consultation process. Absolutely clear that when we were discussing which exemptions should be allowed to continue for the spawning stock, that Marine Scotland did not look at each sector individually. They classed it very much as all or nothing. And I think that was a real mistake. And it's seriously has undermined the trust that has got going forward, and hopefully that can be reviewed. It's really clear that this needs looked at sooner rather than later, and I think that it's evident that Marine Scotland needs to consider the exemptions that will take place next year, accepting that we're already well into this season. So I think that's something the committee really should look at. And directly challenge Marine Scotland on those evidence contributions that they have made.
Thank you. And very briefly, I'll go through all the panel, but if you could just literally keep it to yes, no answers, because I think it is one you can do. Can I go to Russell and then Callum and David and finish with Phil?
No, creeling should still be permitted.
Okay, thank you. Callum?
I think there's evidence there to control it. Could have done it smarter.
Thank you. David?
Creeling should still be totally permitted as well as diving. Can I just say dead quickly that it's obviously a knee-jerk response to the mobile sector to ban it, and that it's totally contrary to the progress we want to make in the future, which is a transition to this kind of sustainable fishing method. So we're cutting our nose off to spite ourselves here.
And Phil?
No, and the evidence the government provided has since been removed from their online website.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for your time this morning. That's been very much appreciated and will help us in our considerations going forward. That now concludes our meeting today. At our next meeting, the committee will take evidence from the Cabinet Secretary on the Sea Fish Prohibition on Fishing, Firth of Clyde Order 2022, and consider the instrument. Consider the Red Rock and Longay Urgent Marine Conservation Order. Consider two SI consent notifications, and consider a draft report on the Good Food Nation Bill. Thank you.